Hello, everybody. In my first video, I told you that the causal fermion system describes a space-time together with many structures therein. Now I want to be a bit more specific and tell you in which sense or why a causal fermion system contains spinners and contains wave functions. And to this end, let us just begin with a causal fermion system. So let H F rho be a causal fermion system. So we can be completely general here. And let's see which structures we have. We already introduced space-time as the support of the measure rho. So therefore, space-time is a subset of curly F, is a set of operators. It has a topology inherited from curly F, so it's a topological space. And the space-time points are linear operators in curly F. So these are symmetric operators of rank at most 2n, which have at most n positive and at most n negative eigenvalues. Okay, so this is the setting. So what can we do next? Suppose we take a space-time point, x in M, be a space-time point. So then this is a linear operator of rank at most 2n. What we do is that we consider its image. So x of h, we denote this by sx. Now this is a subspace of the Hilbert space of dimension at most 2n. So this has dimension small or equal to 2n. And this space is called the spin space. Okay, and on this spin space, we now introduce a sesquilinear form. So maybe the natural thing to do, or like the simplest thing to do, would be simply to take the scalar product of the Hilbert space and restrict it to the spin space. In this way, the spin space would be a finite dimensional Hilbert space. But it turns out that this is not the right thing to do. It is better to introduce on the spin space a sesquilinear form where we take the Hilbert space scalar product of course restricted to Sx cross Sx, but in addition we put here the operator Ax inside. So the operator x is the signature operator, and in this way we get this is a mapping from Sx cross Sx to the complex numbers. It's sesquilinear, so this means it's interlinear in the first and linear in the second argument. And it is in fact an inner product, so it's non-degenerate. But it doesn't need to be positive definite. In fact, it won't be positive definite in general. Instead, it has signature PQ, where P and Q are at most n, because I mean the positive eigenvalues of x give rise to the positive signature, the negative eigenvalues give rise to the negative signature, and therefore the condition on the maximal number of positive and negative eigenvalues tells us here something about the signature of this inner product. Okay, and to be very precise, I should say that we always put here minus sign, which is of no relevance. Somehow this is how things developed. And this inner product is what we call the spin inner product. Okay. So therefore, so let's just write it like this. Also we put a subscript x here for clarity. So this is the spin space which comes with an indefinite inner product, the spin inner product. And we have this at each space-time point. So to every space-time point, there's a corresponding spin space attached, if you like. So therefore, the structure is similar to a vector bundle. Let me just try to draw this. So suppose this is M. I only draw it in one dimension, of course. And then at every point x, I have a corresponding vector space attached, so this is Sx. At another point, I have a corresponding vector space as y. Okay, so therefore, this is really similar to the bundle structure, and I will come back to this a bit more systematically at the end of the video. Good, so now there's a special situation here. Namely, what is different from a usual vector bundle is that all these spin spaces are subspaces of a bigger Hilbert space. So let me try to draw this. So we have our Hilbert space here, just like a high-dimensional vector space. So then there's the origin, and then all the spin spaces are subspaces. So this means, like, let me just draw Sx here like this. So this is Sx, so this is Sy, and so on. So this is like a specific feature of a causal Fermion system, that all these fibers, so all these vector spaces attached to the individual space-time points, all these spin spaces, so they are subspaces of an underlying, of a bigger embedding Hilbert space. Okay. And this is very useful for constructing wave functions in space-time. Let me explain how this works. So first of all, what should be a wave function? Well, if you think of whatever, the Dirac wave function, so then it's like a multi-component function in space-time. So this means to every space-time point, so one associates a vector. Well, and here, of course, it's natural that the vector is a vector in the corresponding spin space. In other words, the wave function is something like a section in this bundle. So psi, let's call it psi, should be a mapping from M to the Hilbert space with a property that psi of x is a vector in Sx for all x in M. So that is similar to a section. This is how we define a wave function. And in fact, there's also like a nice notion of continuity of these wave functions, but maybe that's not so important. I mean, let's not go into the details here. So, I mean, we have the space of continuous wave functions is what we denote by C0 of M SM. Good. Now these are kind of all the possible wave functions. Now, if you want to do physics, we want to be more specific. There should be distinguished wave functions which describe the quantum mechanical particles of our system. So therefore, we want to have certain distinguished wave functions. And this can be done. They arise naturally here, and they are called physical wave functions. Now, what is a physical wave function? And to this end, one starts with a vector in our Hilbert space. So this is just an abstract vector. And now we want to represent this vector by wave function. And this works as follows. So suppose we now consider a space-time point. And then let me draw again the picture we had earlier. So this is our Hilbert space. We have our vector u here. And then we have the spin space Sx, which is a subspace of this Hilbert space. So here we have Sx. What we can do now is that we take the orthogonal projection. So this should here be orthogonal. And in this way we get here a certain vector, which we denote by pi x u. Okay, let's write this down a bit more in detail. So that this pi x, this is a mapping from h to sx. This is simply the orthogonal projection in the Hilbert space. And then we can define psi of x, so the wave function at the point x. We define this as pi x u. And as desired, this is a vector in the corresponding spin space. Okay, so therefore, in this way, we can represent a vector in the Hilbert space by a corresponding wave function. And the set of all these wave functions, this is what we call the physical wave functions. There's one more thing I wanted to tell you in this video, namely the structure of the spinners can also be described by what we call the topological spinner bundle. So what one can do is, one takes the union of all the spin spaces. Now this is then a topological space. It's similar to a vector bundle. But there's a main difference or main advantage, namely we do not need any differentiability assumptions. So everything works here just in the continuous setting. And so we have like a setting for describing spinners in singular spaces, so in non-differentiable spaces. And even more, the dimension of the fiber does not need to be constant. So the dimension of Sx may depend on x. So therefore, this is really like a major generalization of the concept of a spinner bundle. And this is something I worked out together with Nikki Kamran in a paper where you can find many details and also many examples. Okay, I think that's a good point to stop this video. In the next video, I'll explain a little bit more what these physical wave functions are good for. Namely, they give rise to the so-called kernel of the fermionic projector, which also gives rise to geometric structures and all the other structures in space-time which we need. Okay, those. I hope you liked it. See you again soon.